we're here at the Left Forum in 2018, and we are going to have a brief roundtable discussion about public access and public fora in general in the United States. And we are going to put out some questions to one another and to the attendees about where do we go from here, and where it is perceived to be already obsolete, and you know, kind of a dead horse that we don't need to keep beating.
I am also a former public access producer, not at MNN, but oddly enough in Boise, Idaho. But I now am, I study public access television, and I'm a lecturer at UCSD as well.
And I'm Dee Dee Halleck, and I used to be a professor at UCSD in the same department. But right now I'm retired from that, but I'm a producer and activist, and I have been involved in public access.
My name is Jesus Papoleto Melendez, and I am an original founding member of the New Yorican Poets Movement. I'm concerned with community access in relationship as to what it means, community access, access for the community to have media.
It's actually just in terms of like looking at how corporations interact with the public. It is like a way of taxing a public, a corporation. It's a matter of getting channel time, and when a company, a cable company, makes a deal with the city to provide a basic service of television to communities, they need to be able to run their cables and to have access to a certain city infrastructure. And therefore, there has to be some payback to the public and a space on those channels that they are getting a kind of monopoly of providing that isn't a monopoly. And so it's like a legal thing of saying, yes, we will get, the city makes a contract with the cable company, but they say you have to give back to us. And part of the, what they give back is the ability to have a community-owned space and a community channel. And
the Manhattan Neighborhood Network at its prime, as an example of this thing we're calling public access television or PEG access, what did it look like what kind of budget did it have, like what was going on, like can, like how would you describe this to someone who still like doesn't know what this is?
In Manhattan they got cable, and then for many years they had channels, but there was no infrastructure, there was no studios, there was nothing. And Paper Tiger, which was a collective that I was part of, was able to lease a studio. We actually paid for it. So, and we suddenly realized, looking at other cities, that there were free studios, and actually in many cities, quite nice studios. So we did a lot of investigation, and we found out that MNN really was a lot behind other municipalities, and so we found out that there was there were some escrow funds that had been kept in the Franchise Bureau. It was a huge fight. It was like going down to the city council and marching around. We made puppets of TV cameras and TV monitors, and we marched for free speech, and we testified at the hearings. The city council had hearings, And it didn't just happen. It took, I think, 4 years. We formed a group called Nicorum New York Citizens Committee for Responsible Media. Finally, with the help of Ruth Messenger, who became the borough president, and she said, look, this is wrong. We should have a facility conference last year. She and other people actually wrote the bylaws, which are really quite unique among public access cable, and they're very comprehensive, I think, really useful in terms of like who would be on the board of directors of it, and everything had to be reported back to the public. I started getting involved more recently with MNN because looking at the bylaws and looking at the way it was being run, it was completely,
it's not matching up.
It just completely not just not matching up, actually counter to a lot of the original notions of what a public access could be.
Okay, so we're going to talk about a lot of that. Matt, so also as a public access producer, can you say a little bit about PEG Access in Boise? Like how, you know, the size, the resources, and how did you get involved, and what did that mean for you?
I got involved as a college student. The University, Boise State University that I was at, the public access station was created by two professors. And so they taught college production courses and community media production courses through that. And when I first, I was completely amazed. I had no idea. I'd never heard about it at all. And I went to this class, and I'd just taken, I got a mass media journalism bachelor's degree. And so we were learning a lot about like what the types of news that people used to vote. And you know, and I just got done with the class. It was like, you know, one of the statistics was like 95% of people get their voting information that they use to vote from television. And so then I go to this public access television, and like there, you know, there's no one there. Like, why doesn't anybody use this, right? If that's where you get your information to vote, why wouldn't you want to use this to get, like, you know, to like check, you know, corporate media and stuff like that? And it blew me away. Why nobody used this? And I felt like I wish I would have known it was there around before, because I would have, you know, wanted to do it at an early age, because I liked film and television and stuff at an early age. So it blew my mind. So I mean, I never really wanted to go to college to study public access, but it's been such this positive force. I was a producer for 8 years, and I had my own live show on Friday nights, and a call-in, and I helped get a round table with the city council people after the council meeting, and people could call in and talk, so I helped get that together. We would do poetry slams. We would have people come in. We did like, you know, Halo tournaments on television before there were YouTube, you know. So it was sort of like, it was a pretty amazing experimental sort of thing. And it was in Boise, Idaho, all places, on the middle of the wilderness, you know. Like, it was amazing. And so I ended up doing internships. I got hired there or whatever. And when I went to college, it was sort of like, I still have, why don't people use it? Like, that's still my burning desire, why don't people use it? And so part of this has been this, like, journey of, like, you know, a lot of my research is how does public access stay relevant in today's media ecology, like, access-rich ecology, right? So how does public access as a television, as like, kind of old-school television on cable, through all of these, you know, cord-cutting campaigns and all of that, which I think is disastrous, but because of the franchises and the way that it's linked to the city, the important part that I've realized is that public access television is not just an outlet for television. YouTube, you have Twitter, you have all of these things. So the fact that it's an outlet isn't necessarily as important as the fact that it is a community infrastructure that is tied to the city in terms of franchises. And just like Didi was suggesting, and they protest, and that's exactly kind of what happened in San Francisco, where I studied, was in 1972, you know, there was this Robert Gonzalez, the first Latino Board of Supervisors. A lot of community groups were going to him, going, hey, you know, they're redlining our, there was, Viacom was redlining, building out in the poor neighborhoods around downtown. And KQED had just cut funding to the Mission Media Arts, which was the first sort of Latino production company that were creating this television show called Mission 24th. And it was sort of like one of the only sort of televisions about and for people of color in the Bay Area. And the PBS just, or KQED kind of just took away their funding. So they protested, and part of this protest became like, it wasn't a protest about the outlet, it was about resources. And I like that that's what Dee Dee was talking about, is like, it's a resource, and public access television becomes battle for public resources, not just the media outlet. So what happened is, Gonzalez basically threatened that we should do a moratorium, you know, on cable until they give us public access television. So public access television becomes this way to manipulate, or a way to negotiate for citizens, not only to have their television shows as an outlet, but to negotiate, to like scale up, basically, is what I, you know, Neil Smith calls it scale jumping. But it's a way that people, I can elevate my political influence on another scale. I can go to the city council, I protest out of that, you know. And then the city council in San Francisco, that's where you, if you had a problem with Viacom, you went to the city council would go to Viacom, and then they would negotiate. But the city council never knew how to negotiate with Viacom unless people protested and got upset. And so there was this huge, it was like a, you know, it was an infrastructure for public meetings and government and things like that. And I think that that's, that part, if public access television goes away, will lose that ability for people to sort of like, not only to broadcast their views and be on television, which is important, but also to have this political infrastructure that people can use to like, you know, address the city council, address corporate media.
Right. Well, like for me, I found out about it through, like, there's this entity called Downtown Community Television, and I took a little class there to learn documentary video making, and then and I paid for it. And then folks said, hey, if you live in Manhattan and you have a Manhattan address, you can actually take lots of classes and workshops for free, and you can use these studios and this whole thing. And at the time, I didn't live in Manhattan, and I just thought, wow, what, really? There's free, you can make, you know, TV shows and stuff for free. And then, you know, fast forward a few years later, I was living in Harlem, and I was also organizing with people who have incarcerated loved ones, and then we received a community media grant, which apparently are no more, but we received a grant through a program that Betty Yu was running at the time, and that afforded us some equipment and some training, and so for our members and everything, we were able to make shows about issues affecting people who had incarcerated loved ones. And so that has, you know, for me, that made Manhattan Neighborhood Network kind of something that was dear, you know, to my heart. Like, I thought, wow, this is such an amazing thing here, from the people who were working there to the kinds of opportunities that were provided in terms of just anyone, you know, no money being transacted there. And so I've always been interested in what's going on there with that, and, you know, as well as WBAI and other, you know, like public resources like this. Now, Papaleto, before Manhattan Neighborhood Network ended up creating a space in El Barrio, were you involved with public access at all? Like, were you kind of down with
yeah,
the MNN?
Yeah, well, what
so
happened?
So how did you get involved then in being a public access producer?
Well, first I met Dee Dee when I was living in California, after I had left New York in 1980. Then I met Dee around 88, when I moved to, when I went to Mexico. And, you know, Dee was at the communications department at UCSD, so we got to hang out, we did some videos, she did a lot of my poetry readings. hanging out with Exile Genius, Eugene Mingus, and Chaka Uber. You filmed those sessions. You invited us to the studio so that her students could film. And plus, Diddy was an activist in the Chicano movement over there, or the immigration controversy when they were building the stupid wall with the pylons. Remember, we had a big demonstration where the guy ran over some of the demonstrators with his car. Remember, over the bush. So we've been involved like that. And, to me, it was interesting fodder for poetry and political work. But Diddy was doing it, filming over there with the Chan. And she taught me how to use, I had not really dealt with the technology. Diddy gave me a camera, told me shoot this and that. And so I became fond of that because it's like a medium, instant gratification, not like poetry. You shoot something and then you edit it, then you feel good about it. You disseminate it, That's what I learned about that, So we were doing that. Then I don't know if you came to New York or I came to New York first, but my whole stint in the West Coast ended, and I came to New York and I found out, Diddy was up in Woodstock. So we continued our relationship, plus it became a refuge for me, coming back, like, culture shock from the West Coast, coming back to the East Coast, the dark East Coast in the room. So we've been hanging out, we did more work, and then actually when I came back to New York, I hooked up with not Manhattan Neighborhood Cable, but the program they have in Lehman, the Bronx,
okay.
BronxNet.
Yeah.
And I took their field, field production, mm-hmm. and their studio production there. And I got certified for those things. I was living in my mother's house in the projects over in, what's now Sotomayor projects. It was Rosedale then. Sotomayor. And my mother's lived there since the 70s. I was shacking up there because, I'd been in New York, but I had some of my stuff in the West Coast. And I got certified in the Bronx. Then, because I'm a poet, I teach poetry, we were working in East Harlem, which is where I'm from, East Harlem. That's where I grew up. All my, maturation comes from there until I moved to the Bronx in the mid-60s. So there's all this history, between, me and New York. I'm a reluctant New Yorker. But quintessential New Yorker, mm-hmm. meaning, my parents came from Puerto Rico and I was born here. So, also conceived in Puerto Rico. Was born here, so that's like an added thing. Anyway.
Extra authentic.
Yeah, right. I get a little stamp there on my, my imaginary cosmic versatility. But anyway, but all of this is video stuff that we've been doing. When I go back, prodigal son to East Harlem, El Barrio, I'm working with an after-school program with teenagers, and we're teaching them how to use video and all that. And then Eminem does have this satellite, mini satellite.
Then the
under
downstairs,
right.
Trying to go
right.
down the stairs,
yes. Lexington Avenue between 106 and 107th Street. Mm-hmm. Because those used to be bars in the 50s, the 40s, 50s, and 60s, and speakeasies and shit. Mm-hmm. So if it was cool, it would have been quite bohemian, but it wasn't. So they had these classes that they would offer to the community, which were the community access grants, you have organizations in the barrio that are community-based, and they're paying, their art education community-based programs, and they're paying these exorbitant rents, like Taller Boricua over Julio de Burgos. They pay $7,000 a month or something like that, and they still got to do programming that they offer to the community. If they didn't have to pay that rent, they'd have more money for programming. It's not even math, arithmetic. But when Eminem came in there and started over, that was a good thing. We could learn video, get certified. But I was already certified. It's the thing. But I went through the certification again, because anyway, I like to do things twice. I get better at it instead of telling you to do it. You know, I've noticed that. That's what rehearsals are for. So, you know, it was a good, it was but we, in the Spanish called sencillo, you know, right? Very low key. But the program was that they would train, if you lived in Manhattan or you were working with an organization that served the public in Manhattan, you could take their training at the satellite on Lexington Avenue, get certified for field, and not really, what do you call it?
Studio.
Yeah, because they didn't have it.
They didn't have a studio over there in that space.
Right, mm-hmm. But you could go down to 50 over here.
Yeah.
50 over here.
Right,
yeah. Work right here. So it was all cool. But when you finished the program and like you could get a cadre of workers together from the same organization, they could take this training, then they would award you with all this equipment, the computer, lights, a tripod, microphones, lavaliers, the whole
kit
and caboodle, and you could go out there and create a community video. And then you go back to Eminem and, you know, with no other recompense to you, and them, and infinitum. It was cool. It was a fair trade in First Amendment thing.
So then, right?
You know,
they built the firehouse.
So they cut that out. They closed that for a while. Okay. And that was the end of the community grants. And then they, while they were building the firehouse. The firehouse is on 104th Street, abutting a police station that I remember, that's the 23rd Precinct, original, you know, like Car 54 type, you know, where are you? Then they hired Iris. I remember it was like near the Three Kings Day parade, right at the beginning of the year, whatever year that was, 2013.
Yeah.
Yeah, and 12, right. I was excited, you know, because Iris has a legacy. She's a young lordist, and you know, she's supposed to be progressive and everything. I was really happy, you know, when Eminem comes to a barrio like that with the firehouse and everything, you know, I think it's a community service. I think, you know, wow, chevere, we're gonna go in there and work and everything. So I became part of the leadership, the community leadership program that Iris was running, and they were gonna train us in everything that I already knew, you know, to do video and go on community. But that never happened. The program, you know, moved in snail space, you know, like, which is what I hate about college. But anyway, so the thing is that in the meanwhile, the ad hoc committee to reinstate the
community media grant,
right, was trying to go to the board meetings, right, and so here they have a facility in my community, and I'm trying to go to the board meetings too. I just wanted to go to the board meetings to support the ad hoc committee. I'm not part of it, but I agree with, like, hey, we should have, you know, because I know the effect and I know the empowerment.
And that's what that
right, right. Right. Right, right, right. Yeah. I'm always part of some ad hoc committee. Anyway, so, so what happened was that with those efforts, I remember that the borough president asked me one night what the hell was I doing there at Eminem. You know, when I told her they opened a pizzeria in the neighborhood and I want a slice of pizza. you know, being metaphorical. And that was that guy that got insulted by Dan that night that we went to the meeting. Anyway, so what happened was, I was taking a course.
What kind of public engagement or discussion process like starts to take place at this point, right?
Not in the community leadership program. They were just teaching us. It was like teaching us how to use video and stuff with a politically correct title. You know, because it's just the same damn program. It's just that they're, you know, there's nobody in power to do nothing. Especially if you did leadership like I did. So what happened was that Dan felt pressured or something and then demanded that Dee Dee, myself, and who else, the three of us, go to Can Attend. You know, we were like, invited and compelled at the same time to attend that board meeting in March while I'm part of the leadership program, which was on the same day that I had a leadership workshop. So at 7 o'clock, I go downstairs when that's supposed to happen, you know, when the meeting was. And everything, you know, they threw us out of that meeting, right? Just tell us to stop recording, whatever the hell was. And that's when I got kicked out of the leadership program by Iris Morales. And okay. That's what caused, you know, me to enjoy and all of this, because it's not, you know. I personally, I don't believe in the First Amendment. I just have a right to do stuff because I'm a poet anyway. So this just infuriates me on the technicality.
Right. Matt, let me ask you, like, in terms of what you know about the FCC and, like, the mandates and franchises and this kind of thing, like, from what you're hearing here, right, what's wrong with this picture? You know, like, would you want to offer some of, like, what shouldn't have been happening here? Or, you know, like, what are some of the problems with...
Lots of nasty stuff happens in public access because the FCC created a, like, system to create public access, but it never mandated. It said cities could do this if they want. If a city asks the cable company for channels, then they have to write it in, but it's not mandated, right? So if a city doesn't ask, then the cable company doesn't have to provide them, right? So it all becomes a part of, and this is why it's so important, is it becomes a part of a city's political machine, and whether you're getting this and how they're set up and who's running it and what, because the city's also, most of, San Francisco, for instance, from 1972 until 1998 was run by Viacom, by the cable company. And it caused all of these different problems, and they created producer committees and producer unions at some times, and Viacom would, like, not fix the air conditioning to reduce the studio time. They would pull stuff like that. So they fought forever to get, part of this whole redlining history came about, and owing money and not paying this, they got caught. And part of the deal for a new franchise, the city was gonna allow a new franchise if the cable company gave up control. So then a nonprofit that the city appointed, right? But it's always been the city appoints a nonprofit. There's not, mm-hmm. And they create these nonprofits. And so it does become part of, but there's no, it does become part of the political machine, but there's no, like, rules about how to create these things. And so they become, it becomes the trial and error. And there's all these different, I mean, you know, the access in Seattle was always going to court about obscenity and things like that. So there's all of these rules about what is the power that these nonprofit organizations can have and cannot. And they're sort of, they just sort of get manipulated in, oh, is the city gonna allow it or is it not?
Right.
And so, to say your question, the FCC doesn't give you any direction other than, like, I mean, in 1972 order, first report in order was that any cable service that has over 3,500 subscribers has to provide a studio space and a training and equipment. And then in 1979, Midwest 2, they said you don't have to, but if the city asks you, you have to. But you don't just have to provide it unless the city asks. So it kind of got changed there, but yeah, I mean, but other than that, there's no.
It's like a frenzy.
That's why it gets messy, and that's why it gets, and that's why that's why I think it is a particular scale of politics that is important for community members. Because it's a community infrastructure. It's part of the telecommunication infrastructure. One of the things that they did in San Francisco was that, you know. They would go, my neighborhood is being redlined, and they would send somebody out and find out, well, is this happening? Is this being redlined? Okay, well, you're being redlined. That's a mark against your franchise next time we do a franchise negotiation. No, you can't raise cable rates because you're redlining this area, right? So it was a way for, like, the producers could actually manipulate, and, you know, obviously they would have to come together, they would have to go to city council meetings and stuff like that, but as an organization and a community that, you know, just of producers, they could go and say, like, we want these changes, this is not fair for us, this is, you know, Viacom is doing this, and Viacom is doing that, did it take that long to repair the air conditioning? Okay, yeah, it did. Well, you know what, your next rate, we're not, you know, because until you
facilitate this, we will not be able to raise your rates, right? So, I mean, they could go back and forth, and that's a lot of power for people to negotiate against Viacom, of all corporations, right? So, so that's I mean, I think it's, you know, when you start hearing that, you know, on a whim or in technicalities, people can no longer be part, people aren't allowed, and I mean, we've always right. been able to videotape their open meetings. They're supposed to be public open board meetings.
Right.
From my understanding. Right. So to not videotape, I've never really, I mean, that happened at Bayback a couple of times, and they tried to twist it in terms of hostility and everything, but if you look at the videotapes, there's no hostility, it's just like, okay, we don't want. There was an also issue, the last thing I do have to say, and I'll go, is that the problem with in San Francisco was that the Bay Area Video Coalition was doing other things other than public access. So when they would have board meetings, they would address public access, and then everything else was just their stuff. That becomes their priority, and they start using, they get this franchise money that is just now capital, because the state franchising, you can't charge for administrative costs, and you can't charge for, like, you know, insurance for people to work there anymore, you know, like all of that, what is it, capital, and what's the other expense? Yeah, it's an administrative, like, you can't, you can only use the state franchising law, DIVCA in 2000, the Digital Infrastructure and Video Competition Act in California in 2006 created it so that they can only use franchise money for capital payments.
Like building-related overhead, like not...
you can't pay for like
staff
or wages. So that becomes a problem. And so when Bayback the city gave it to Bayback because they had this $1 million grant, get it. And I love Bayback, I'm not taking it wrong, I'm just taking it as an example of what can go wrong, is that all of their investment is not in public access. And so it gets they don't hire, or if they need another staff member, they're like, oh, well, we went through that. Or the equipment's down, oh, well, we'll wait till the next thing. But Bayback can borrow the public access equipment and use for their stuff, but the public access can't borrow Bayback's equipment and use it. You see what I'm saying? So this is very much, it's sort of, and so you have this family that has the, like, adopted, you know, child that they don't want, but they're associated with because they get a big franchise every year.
We got together and felt that this is wrong. There should be a better situation. And I think that's one of the positive things about public access, and I think you kind of touch on it, Matt, is that it makes people realize that they can have some degree of control over some of these municipal institutions and corporations. But it just doesn't happen. It's not, you have to organize. It's really an organizational problem. And what I saw happening at MNN was there was what I thought was quite successful community media grant program, which was just arbitrarily cut off, and it was
and
people like Papaletto lost his job, other people lost jobs, and it lessened the kinds of dialogue that was happening on the cable channels, because all of a sudden it was only the kind of vanity video people who really wanted, who were trying to get a job or trying to sell their exercise equipment or whatever, who were using the channel, and or their fashion show. There's a lot of fashion show stuff, but there's no welfare mothers organization, which was one of the groups that got the original public access. There's no Asian Cinevision on a regular program. And there were community organizations that had regular programs on. And I just, what's going on here? This is really wrong. It's up to the people, like, really to do that. You're saying, well, there's flexibility, but it's also, if there's pressure, people make it. And we knew that there would be problems with this, so that's why we said that the board of directors had to have three functioning public access producers on, people who had shows on, that because we wanted them on the board, and that there would be somebody from the educational system, that there would, we, it's actually in the friend, in the bylaws of the organization that has the franchise, that, and that there should be somebody from labor unions on the board. So it just seemed like the kind of thinking we had put into forming the organization to run public access was being all of it completely dismissed and started at something else.
So then you sued them.
So well then they, because I filmed that Papo talking about it, it didn't. They said I was banned from going into the public access. It was like, what? How can you ban me for recording something, even if it was blasphemous or whatever? I was just the person recording it. But then what happened was, I said, okay. I got a letter saying, what your sentence, what you said was one sentence that said that if someone's in there that won't let me in, I'll have to wait till they die, whatever, or get killed. And that was in the letter of my banning. It said that sentence is wrong. So I said, okay, I'll take it out.
Right.
So I made a version that had a big black circle around Papa's mouth saying censored, and so I put it up on YouTube.
Right.
And they said because it was on YouTube, that was a violation of their station policy, because it was a threat to one of the workers who was there, and therefore that I was banned for a year. So it was a year plus 3 months. I mean, it's just absurd because
this get off early for good.
So we've gone the legal route. And what's interesting is that it sort of goes back to very essential issues, which is about public space. Mm-hmm. And is public access a public forum?
Exactly.
And what they are contending, which is to me like unconscionable, how can it be that public access is not a public forum? Because if it is not a public forum, that means that every public access around the country whatever their function, their basic premise of being is that they provide a public space to the community. And if they're not, then there's no reason for ever letting anybody talk except some mouthpiece for the corporation. And it's like...
Or for the city.
Or for the city,
exactly.
The city
can just take the...
Yes.
Okay. They've always been private. Like, the cable companies have always owned the channel. They just, as part of their agreement, they give the city control over a certain amount of the channels. And I think one of the arguments that I read was that wasn't enough to suggest that the city or that the stations were an arm of the state, because it was private owned. But then it was also the nonprofit. Something about like that first forum didn't, or public forum didn't apply because they weren't arms of the state, or you couldn't, there wasn't a direct line as an arm for the state, so they couldn't be considered. They didn't have the obligation of First Amendment protection. But I think my understanding of public forum law is that historically, one of the things that they look at, I could be wrong, but I think my understanding is what is the history and tradition of a space? Mm. Meaning, is there an expectation, and always been, that this space is used for this historically? And then
And then, is there an equal alternative to this? Are one of our different reasons why public forum law gets negotiated in those types of things? So,
Dee, you look like you want to say something about that.
No, no. I think that to me, this whole I think it's very. This is like a crux, and in fact, it was used in this recent case about Twitter. About Trump denying people access to Twitter to criticize him, and they actually use some of our arguments in terms of the case that about MNN and about how it is a public forum. But it brings up to me, I think, the whole question of whether or not we have public forums. When I think, if you two blocks from here. Is where the city, through eminent domain, tore down a zillion of people's apartments, really thousands of people's apartments, to build Lincoln Center. And it was on the basis that they were creating a kind of public space, that they could do that, or that was more important, you know? And, you know, we all, public, it's a beautiful space, whatever. But, like, during Occupy, we went to try to march there. And you were not allowed to go into the plaza with any signs. You can't have any, it's not a forum for any political message, any
expression.
Like public Disneyland.
Expression, yeah. If we win, I'd say the next step to me is Lincoln Plaza. I think we could really have a good case for that we could say public right. access, it public should be public. Allowed in on that plaza. There's no reason people can't go and march around.
Yeah, and Central Park too, because that destroyed a lot of African American communities. This was Central Park is all about, you know. So that'd be interesting.
Yeah. Well, so okay, but what about this question of if there's a viable alternative or something, and then this question about Twitter and the internet, and basically now we're kind of in some ways getting into your work, which is about space and spatialization and some of these kinds of questions. I think maybe around like. Borders and defining like what maybe some of that means. And then also, you know, again, this broader question of like public forum, where are they? What are they? Do we need them? How do we need them?
What was the original reason for public access television in the first place? And there's a version that says, you know, it was a compromise between the city and, you know, there's the compromise between the city and the cable company. There's a compromise. There's a version of why it was here that suggests that it was land rent or a compromise between corporations and the city. But for me, that's narrow because it doesn't take into account activism. That there was lots of media activism during the 70s and broadcast reform movements and things, and people asking for it, and people like demanding, and not even leftist activists, but like even, you know, ultra right, you know, just too much violence on television, you know, or too much sex on television, anything like that. So a lot of people were battling that television question in the first place. And then let's not forget that there is a history of the FCC of like public interest and trying to like. That's originally when there was a broadcast television license freeze in the 50s was so they could figure out how to regionalize. And they would regionalize licenses so that every community of a certain size had a broadcast television. And that's a very spatial argument that says, we need, you know, it also helps technically so that spectrum aren't, you know, the broadcast signals aren't causing interference and things like that. So there's more than just that rent. There is a history of it being about public interest and public affairs, right? For instance, the station in Salem has become with the city's help, the in a case of an emergency, it becomes like the central communication place.
Absolutely.
And that was worked out through, like, because they were kind of at, they're kind of at the library, they're kind of at City Hall in Salem, Oregon. So so they have negotiated with the city this, like, even to the point where their windows are like disaster-proof windows or whatever, like shatterproof windows, because it becomes, they're creating this communication hub in case of an emergency. Another one, let's see, was it in Santa Clara or was it some east of San Francisco, has a after-school program.
Yeah.
So kids will go there in a shuttle after school. Do video production, and then parents pay like they would any other after-school program, but it's about television production.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think that there's important things that, like, these are not the things that you get making a video and posting it on YouTube, right? Like, those are the things, like, making television with people in a studio and you know them and you create this, like, you create these community groups. What did cable access do? Well, cable access came at a particular time period. When, right as they passed these laws, so did they get rid of media ownership laws. Right? They got rid of this, you used to, at broadcast television studios, they used to have studio logs and things like that that the public could go in and see, like, what public affairs were you. Well, when public access started going, they systematically, up until 1996, got rid of those obligations by local broadcast television studios. And this is because there was this idea that cable access could do that. If every city had a channel that they could access, then, you know, we'll just put broadcast television.
Their obligations.
They lost their obligations as cable access kind of became more prominent around.
Right.
And so you see this, because again, we're talking about corporate liberalism. You're seeing technology and communication technology in general as a broad national infrastructure. So radio, satellite, microwave, all of these things, and cable television are working together as one system, not separate systems. All of these very much important ways that people win legal battles. You win legal battles on precedent. You win legal battles on what happened before. I mean, this is how judges that negotiate these things. So. What was the intent of the FCC when they wrote it in 1972? Why did they do that? Was it so that eventually they weren't going to be public forums? Because if it's not a public forum, it's a private channel, and private channels make money. So it's written in the law, in the FCC rules, mm-hmm. that the cities cannot control. So it can either go to Viacom, which was all, or it could go to the corporation, which also in these rules were that they couldn't censor. You couldn't censor programming. Like, they could just provide, but they could not look at the program and censor it. Mm-hmm. So those were in the FCC. So the FCC's original intent for these channels was free speech. For me, it just goes against. I know there's this question of private and everything, but it goes against all sort of policy precedent since the beginning of it. What happens if they aren't public forums? I could see corporations going to cities going, if you're not using it for its original intent, we're no longer giving it to you.
teaching facility. Right. That was important. Right. Because a lot of people, like when I worked in the adult education program, for instance, you know, over at Union Settlement, right, with Melissa. And you remember that, that we had the opening for the what do you call it, premiere? What happens is that these are people who, okay, it's an adult education program. So they're not in the educational program, they're trying to get either their GED or English as a second language. So, okay, the kids that are from here are young people that dropped out of high school and now realize they need a damn education. So they go to the adult education program. They're immigrants who need to learn how to speak English. The people that are gonna take their the exam to become citizens and so forth. So they come to, so we had a program called Hands-On English, right?
It was an ESL.
Yeah, English for the Second Language, Hands-On English, right? And we use video. And so, you know, because tripod, you know, terapia, camera, you know, all these things, so you learn English by making video, you see? And people, and so we had, we picked certain community issues, you know, police harassment of teenagers and so forth. And we went out there, we filmed these things, you know. See, the thing is, I'm just working. I have a job to teach people how to write, how to speak English, these Latinos how to speak English and deal in an English environment. My only investment is that I'm a poet and I understand English. I'm a Latin from Manhattan, so I understand Spanish. Okay, but I'm not interested necessarily in the topic matters that they're doing, but they are. You see, they are. And that's what they want to film. And that's the power of public access. And at the same time, it's teaching them language, you know, because we're communicating bilingually and all of this, and editing. And see, but the thing is that a lot of these people have never touched a computer, a keyboard. There's that, you know what I mean? Like, it's like, yeah, there's the pen, but then there's that, and that's like a mystery, it's intimidating, it's got all these buttons, and you know, you can always do something wrong, you know what I mean?
And actually, that's
what... But then it's
what,
empowering, right?
Yeah, and that's what Eminem cut out. And in fact, when I first talked to this was before the board meeting. I went and had a meeting with the two directors, Dan and the associate director or whatever. And I said, well, you know, we really want the community media. And they said, oh, well, we thought the programs weren't professional enough. We want to, if somebody brings us a problem, we'll have professionals make a program.
Right, tell them about the premiere that the students had.
And it was so beautiful.
We threw the curtain up on the damn wall, remember?
Yeah.
We did a sheet, goddammit. It was sheets of paper that were real big, and we glued them to the wall. And
it was such an amazing community event, it was made by the kids there.
All we needed was a red damn carpet, because it was like that. We didn't have one, but it was like that. You know?
That, to me, is when public access really works, and I've seen places where it's just amazing. I remember seeing these teenage kids who were doing a hip-hop show, were helping these older women who did a bell ringing show, and they were they were after him, and the bell ringers needed a camera person, so they ended up having all these hip hop kids who were the program before, or maybe it was the program after, but whatever. But they were they were saying, "Wow, these people are so cool! Like the bells, they were starting to do bells themselves." So that it's like those in our society, very few. Okay, we can go online and you can look at the women, do the things, but it's that culture, yes. It's that encounters that the best of public access makes happen, and it can be wonderful. And I just see that dying in the situation here in Manhattan.
One of the stories that I came across that really sort of meant what public access. You know, not just an outlet, right? One of these guys, he was African American, homeless, just got out of prison, living at a shelter, and when you have that subjectivity, you are instant. You go through different institutions, like the office and, or the welfare office and the housing office and the unemployment office, and they have you in this category, right? And he had this daily way he would maneuver through the city, and one of those was to go to the public access station, and that was the space where he learned to do video, took the programs, met people who then gave him recommendations for jobs, was on people's shows, created his own shows, and he created a hip-hop show because in prison they would watch the California channel at 5:30 and it would be local rap artists. And so he was like, I want to put my show on, and people, I know I'm going to put it on at 6:30 and that they can watch it right after the California channel, right? So that is something that YouTube doesn't necessarily... So he creates a whole sort of way of mapping the city in terms of his own welfare, and it becomes part of how he navigates the city, and a space that becomes his own, that he doesn't fit into this I am a criminal, I am homeless boxes, right? It beats on his own terms. And that is not something that I mean, maybe you two could do it. I haven't heard of that experience coming out of people in terms of their YouTube use, but in terms of, like, that's why I fully believe that that's why I'm pushing this community infrastructure as a communication infrastructure, not simply an outlet, because that becomes part of his daily habit, the way he was, had a, you know, like, sort of self-healing for him. He was meeting people, he found people to write recommendations for jobs and things like that. So that's what I think, and I think this has to do with what you guys were talking about, is encounter, these community and cultural encounters. Like, this is where you come to people that you might not meet at any other way, and you might not even get along, but I'll help you shoot your show if you help me shoot mine, and we'll both get what we want, right? Or what we feel like we need. And so that's why that is what I think is the most important part about public access, and
access
would be a shame.
And you know, like a group of, like, I don't know, senior citizens walking around with video equipment through a barrio.
Right.
You know, I mean, that itself is a National Geographic moment.
You know, more and more and more, the physical architectures and the designs, you know, are all moving us away and further away from one another. I think that this is a key case and area of study and reflection around why it's important for us to preserve and fight for, and thank you for, you know, doing that, to save these spaces, but to augment them as well, and to hopefully, you know, like, we need to birth more little baby public spaces that can grow, I think. And YouTube, for me, or, you know, the internet and its, I think, false promise of democracy, is not that space, is not that place.
Thank you.